A good afternoon to ladies and gentlemen, for and a warm welcome to all of you to the first ever speaker series of Techignite 2021. I am Shara, and here with me is Joanne, and we are your MCs for today. I'm seeing a few familiar names from the welcome session. Thank you for joining us back again. Our first speaker session will delve into the potential of additive manufacturing in the present as well as in the future. If you're inspired by the talk by Dr. Ho Chaw Sing, you can sign up for our 3D printing workshops brought about by our own MAE students in order to get firsthand experience. Just to let you know that you can scan the QR code on the bottom left of the screen to direct you to the website that we will be accessing your questions from for the Q&A session afterwards. Once you're directed to the website, please include the hashtag TechIgnite to post your questions. So without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Ho Chaw Sing, our first speaker to kick off TechIgnite 2021. Dr. Ho, please.
Thank you, Sarah. I hope everyone can hear us now. So first and foremost, let me thank the organizers, Eileen and Professor Andy Kong from Triple E, for having me here today at this TechIgnite speaker series. I'll be talking a little bit about additive manufacturing and its role in the future of production. Before I start, I just want to give you a brief introduction about myself. I've spent about 16 years in the private sector before I was brought in to start the National Additive Manufacturing Innovation Cluster, which is NAMIC for short. For today, I'll talk through these outline. I'll give you a sense of the context of the world today, and of course, a deep dive into where we are in terms of additive manufacturing technology, as well as the landscape from a market perspective. And then I'll be also covering quite a bit on several examples of innovation and industrial manufacturing powered by additive manufacturing, with several case studies from various industry sectors that we are working on. And I'll round it up with a conclusion at the end. So first and foremost, NAMIC. So we are a national platform started 6 years ago by the National Research Foundation in partnership with Enterprise Singapore and the Singapore Economic Development Board. The role and mandate given to us is to look into how we can help transform and enhance our industry by orchestrating breakthrough strategies for the future of production. So we do this by a couple of ways, through jump-starting public-private collaborations. We develop problem statements from the industry. We matchmake the research performers with our cluster entities at the universities, as well as the A-Star research institutes. And of course, we develop the AM ecosystem in Singapore, basically to create the supply and demand a business part of the entire value chain of the AM. Our vision really is about enabling this future where we can live in a carbon neutral world with resource efficiency built in into our products and solutions, enabled by on-demand manufacturing using sustainably sourced and recycled materials. And I'll run through a few of these examples of what we mean by how we use recycled materials and how do we do on-demand manufacturing with additive manufacturing. And a few key points I hope that you can take away from today's talk is additive manufacturing enables design freedom. You can see the picture that is given there. This is an example that was designed with the topology software. So you can see it looks like a coral reef, but it's actually not a coral reef. It's a heat exchanger. It's a heat sink, actually. So you can create these kind of very nature-inspired designs and can print it. The second concept, and I hope that you can understand, is also the concept of a digital warehouse compared to a physical warehouse. So what it means is we, instead of having physical inventory, and traditionally businesses want to minimize physical inventory because they want to improve their cash flow. So you, instead of having these products that is shelved, you actually have this in the digital cloud and ready to be downloaded, to be printed, according to customer needs. The third concept is about the role of additive manufacturing in the future of sustainability. And one of the key enablers for that is in beyond the design freedom, as I just talked about, is the use of recycled materials as feedstock. So there'll be some examples given on there. And last but not least is this concept called decentralization of manufacturing. I'm sure a lot of you today have read about the current supply chain challenges. Today's supply chain is basically built using a very centralized concept, what we call a spoke and hub model. Essentially, we centralize manufacturing at the lowest cost countries, and then we will then ship these products to a centralized distribution hub before we go through a very complex logistic freight exercise to bring goods to every part of the world. What we want and what we would think is should be done is decentralize the manufacturing and supply chain so that you no longer have to ship parts and products all over the world, and therefore reducing the freight-induced carbon footprints. We do this, I mentioned earlier about how NAMIC does it. We essentially focus on the value capturing research outcomes from our public institutes and elevating and solutioning these research outcomes to the technology level that companies can adopt for commercial implementation. And we do this by through grants and of course orchestrating partnerships and even creating consortia where we have this multipartite partnerships that can scale at a commercial level. And so today, these are what I think a lot of you would in some way subscribe to. You know, customers like ourselves want more innovation in terms of the design in the products that we use. You want more features, you want faster, also you want it cheaper as well. You know, high performance, you know, I mean, of course I use cars as an example. And then more importantly, also this concept of hyper customization. Everybody likes to have the products, you know, personalized in some ways. And but the truth is that with the way we currently make things, even though we have made stunning strides in recent decades as a global community, in some ways, advancing technology, advancing the way we make, and of course, many economies around the world are. For example, like Singapore is extremely developed, but still there are still some issues that we are now face as at the planetary scale level. Some of these toughest challenge have in fact become a lot worse. You know, I think it's actually not news to most of you that even malnutrition, preventable diseases continue to kill millions, actually straining healthcare systems in both rich and poor countries. And you can see this even in the most recent, you know, the current pandemic crisis that the rich nations are getting all the vaccines or most of the vaccines and poor countries are not getting any. And of course, the devastating threat of climate change looms, hitting the poorest to the hardest. That's why science and technology have been so critical in some ways in the history of civilization. Technology progress expands the possibilities of human achievement, increasing our collective ability to solve the problems that were once considered unsolvable. So first, the progress of science and technology is about to go through the greatest acceleration of all time, as I would demonstrate to you just this additive manufacturing technology. And second is that this is the greatest opportunity we've had in some ways in generations to advance some of these causes of social justice and inequality, and of course, to reduce human suffering. And to do that, we need all our brightest minds. And I think in the audience today, all of you are, most of you, I believe, are from the engineering faculties, and some of you are thinking about going to the engineering education. It's very important that our brightest mind are equipped with the skills and the knowledge, right, to solve some of the most serious problems facing humanity today. And this is something that in some ways I hope this talk today will also help to inspire. If you look at the today, what is driving a lot of the advancements actually starts from this tiny little chip, which is basically enabled by silicon. This has been enabled by this innovation, great innovation in the semiconductor industry over the last 50 years. So I personally came from the semiconductor industry. I started my career there as a device physicist. Today, most of these chipsets that's powering our smartphones and laptops come with at least a few hundred millions of transistors or a billion more in each of this chipset. And each of this costs, you can make a guess, is less than a dollar actually to make these. Of course, these are all fabricated on huge wafers, and we then dice it up to package it to create these semiconductor chips. And so this powers the next, what we call the, this infinite computing, right? Everything today, beyond our personalized computing devices, we have these huge data servers, that's enabling cloud computing as an infrastructure, offering services, offering software solutions. And again, it's all driven by the economics that these semiconductor chips are getting cheaper and cheaper, because the features are getting smaller and smaller, and it's getting much easier, right, to basically to get these products. Notwithstanding the fact that there's a supply chain crunch right now affecting most semiconductor chipsets, we think that this itself is the one that's powering the next huge revolution in technology advancement, and we call it infinite computing. So this confluence of three trends: the exponential increase in available computing power, the democratized access to that power, all of us can access it easily, and also the precipitous fall in the cost of that power. So it's much cheaper for us to access. And we combine these three trends with the scalability that we can now access via the cloud. You can deploy thousands and hundreds of these computers to solve the growing number of challenges that I mentioned earlier, as designers, engineers, and even as artists today. This is a kind of a classic example. I want to show the progress. This is from when the car industry started. This is a Henry Ford factory, and you can see the number of people that is making these cars. It's all handmade. Today, if you look at a Tesla factory. You can see these are robots, actually. It's no longer humans that's doing this. So automation enabled by this infinite computing power, which has this ability to gather and analyze data real time and do the necessary feedback to then help improve the processes. This is no longer science fiction. This is already happening as we speak today. And so the role of additive manufacturing, in a way, is to, beyond the compute power, is really to address some of the elements I mentioned earlier, is the ability to automate, the ability to design, to enable design freedom, to make things in a more sustainable way, so that we can continue to live in a very habitable Earth, right, for the next centuries and thousands of years to come. And so, what exactly is additive manufacturing, and what's the difference between this additive manufacturing or 3D printing, which is also rightly coined as a term, compared to traditional manufacturing? I thought using this schematic will help you to better understand. So in the traditional manufacturing approach, if I use molding, injection molding as an example at the top, you see that it starts with the design, and then you need to make a prototype injection mold, and of course the tooling in order to be able to make these products, and then before you go into manufacture. This traditional way of doing it requires a lot of time. Actually, it's very expensive to make these injection molds and tooling. So it's something that for large production, for high volume production, this makes a lot of sense. But if you talk about 3D printing, essentially look at the bottom schematic, it's basically a digital fabrication tool or technology. So from a design, from a CAD file, that you translate into a 2D STL file, you can then directly ask the printer to print the product that you made. So what does that mean? It means that you can actually make things a lot faster. You can do prototyping much easier and quicker. You can, I would say, design products with complex shapes and geometries that traditionally will not be able to do, that is limited by the traditional approach. I'll show you some examples as we move along. Now, not to go into the technicals, too much technicals about additive manufacturing, but this is a ASTM F42, a standard definition of additive manufacturing. I just want to let you guys know that there is an umbrella of technology that we classify under additive manufacturing or 3D printing. So there is a material extrusion method, which is the most common today. To most of you, it's the fused deposition modeling or the plastic filament printers. Those are very common. They cost a few hundred dollars, you can get them. The more recent technologies that's now gaining traction in the industrial space is binder jetting, material jetting, and powder bed fusion, as well as direct energy deposition. That polymerization is what is also known as stereolithography, or SLA. So this is also very common, together with the material extrusion method. Also very, in most of the printers that you might see, it uses a resin, a bit of resin, and you shine light on it with the shape of the geometry and basically creates the product. So what's the relationship then? I mean, there's lots of technology out there, but what's the interest from it for Singapore, given we are a very relatively small nation? I think it's important to explain to all of you that the Singapore being a small island country, we are very much impacted by all the global forces. Some of these are kind of outlined, not to go too much detail, but climate change issues, the resource sustainability issues, the reshaping of global trade flows, where there's this decline in multilateralism and rule-based trading order. All these actually means that our traditional transshipment hub status, as a kind of an entry port trade hub, as well as being a regional HQ for most multinationals, can actually change if we don't continue to evolve with time. And plus, I mentioned earlier about this increased emphasis, right, on product design for more complexities, part consolidation, meaning you take any product, it may consist of 100 parts, but if you can reduce the number of parts from 100 to 10, that simplifies the supply chain. And of course, lower some of these carbon footprints. And the other point is that there is also this growing interest by the industry for just-in-time manufacturing to lower inventories, to improve business bottom line or cash flow. And more importantly, with the recent black swan events like the pandemic COVID-19, which can cause prolonged disruption of global supply chains. So all these are now pushing us towards looking into additive manufacturing as one of the enablers, as one of the important part for our manufacturing value chain. This is the overview of the market. I think it's always important to understand, even the technology is so promising, how is the industry trend, right, in the last 10, 20 years, and also looking forward in the next 10, 20 years. So you can see for yourself that in the last 10, 12 years or so, the market industry for AM has actually grown exponentially. With the exception of last year, which was a COVID year, and despite that, it still grew about 7.5% year on year. So currently the market size is now projected to grow to anywhere between 50 billion actually to 120 billion by 2025. This is according to various estimates from McKinsey's, from the ARK Invest and Lux Research, as well as Wallace. And one of the important points is that I mentioned earlier that this technology itself is very useful for prototyping, which has been around for the last 20 years, but increasingly is being used for other manufacturing applications, especially in making customized tooling, especially in the automotive industry, where you need these tooling to help you make the cars or do prototyping of the cars. And more importantly, it is now being used increasingly for end product manufacturing itself. And you can see that from the number of patent applications on an annual basis, even in 2020, despite a relatively sort of a low year, you know, there's a lot of innovation that is happening in this space, and a lot of progress in the technology as well. Now, what does this mean to Singapore? I mentioned earlier, Singapore, you know, despite its size, has about 20-21% of the global, the gross domestic product in manufacturing and engineering. And these are some of the sectoral breakdown. We have biomedical manufacturing, we have chemicals, electronics, precision engineering, transport engineering, general manufacturing, so on and so forth, of which most of these actually Singapore are the number one or number two leader, either in Asia Pacific or in the world. For example, in aerospace, I'm not sure any one of you know this, but because of the fact that we are a transshipment hub, we have aviation hub, so there's a lot of maintenance, repair, overhaul operations that is based in Singapore. So we own the basically 25% of the APEC market share for MRO, and we are number one in this space in the Asia Pacific market. And even in the electronic space, you know, for semiconductor equipment, again, not many people know this, but because of our semiconductor fabs, and plus the fact that we're right smack in the nexus of Asia and between the East and the West, more than 25% of the global semiconductor equipment actually are made in Singapore. And so what this means is that if you look across all the sectors, whether medical technology, aerospace, energy chemicals, precision engineering, or even the more traditional transport engineering in marine, offshore, maritime, aerospace, actually, AM has a very big role, even in the built environment space or construction space, which most of you should know that it has not really evolved in the last century. It's still highly manual, and it's not very safe as a safe as an industry. You can actually automate the structural construction using additive-based technologies. Of course, the solution has to be customized for that. And I'll show you some examples of that. So this means that the investment in this area to solution these technology becomes imperative for Singapore. And so under the Research Innovation Enterprise 2025 plan, which is the Singapore equivalent of our R&D roadmap, every 5 years, which is refreshed every 5 years, additive manufacturing together with the other deep tech, you know, such as AI, artificial intelligence, or and automation, are considered extremely important for us to continue our manufacturing hub value proposition, and more importantly, to strengthen our supply chain resistance. And on top of that, it's also important to note that sustainable manufacturing is a key focus. And so Singapore, under the I think the COP26 meeting, which is the climate treaty conference that is held every year, Singapore actually has a carbon a plan, basically, to basically look into halving its carbon net emission or come to net zero as soon as possible, basically, right? So by 2050, it aims to halve its peak emissions. By 2030, aims to hit at its peak emissions. One of the reasons why this number seems not as ambitious from the outsider view is Singapore has a lot of the petrochemical industry in Singapore. So a lot of that needs to be transformed and repivot to other more carbon-friendly output and solutions. And so the areas of where additive manufacturing enables this future of sustainability is as shown, right? So first and foremost, I mentioned about materials. And we know that plastic pollution is one of the biggest problems right now on top of global warming. So we can actually use these plastic or metal waste to be recycled into feedstock that is used for additive manufacturing. The second thing is, of course, in additive manufacturing, and I have more examples, this is a bit small just for you to see on screen, is that you're able to make parts with complex geometries that are using much less materials and with part consolidation. The third thing is the concept of this digital connectivity. I think a lot of you are in some ways millennials. I think you're very familiar with this, digital devices. But one of the things with this hyperconnectivity that we have today means that in a future state, we can now have this distributed manufacturing concept where instead of shipping parts all over the world, you actually ship designs to these authenticated service bureaus that can actually make these parts very close to where the demand is. And then, of course, you then assemble and then distribute. So this is the concept of this distributed manufacturing as opposed to the centralized manufacturing today. So from Singapore, what has happened is in the last 5 or 6 years since NAMIC's formation, we have worked very closely with the economic agencies, with the research institutes, with the universities to create these business ecosystem across the AM value chain. And these includes equipment manufacturers, the software makers, the CATS solution providers like the Autodesk, which I'm sure some of you have heard before, plus new startups, right? For example, like Hyperganic, which I have an example later to show, where they actually use computer coding to design products, not using traditional CAD. And then, of course, you have the material supply chain as well. A lot of these companies have established themselves. One of the companies I will share more later on is MollyWorks. So they basically take scrap metal through their proprietary gas atomizer systems to transform them into powder feedstock for AM. And last but not least, the service bureau, which are dedicated 3D printing solution providers. They can take any digital designs and create the kind of products that you need using 3D printing. So the drivers of AM in the context of Singapore in our industrial manufacturing and to enable the future innovation is really to this basically summarized into three parts. One is on the production side, you want to accelerate design cycle and time to market. You want to make it more sustainable to minimize material waste and even reduce carbon footprints. You can allow complex design, and more importantly, you can do very high mix and low volume production. Okay. The second part is on the supply chain logistics, which I mentioned a couple of times. Reduce the inventory costs of spare parts, and you basically do it on demand, and you shorten and simplify the supply chain, thereby improving customer service. And last but not least, which is the most one of the most powerful, interesting benefit of this technology is the ability to design a new kind of shapes and with simpler parts, with less parts, for better performing systems and components, which are lightweighted, and you can even do it use it for repair applications. Of course, with all these fantastic advantages, what are some of the consideration and barriers to adoption? Just like any technology, the total cost of ownership investment required is very high. Access to human skill expertise is still something that needs to be worked through. It's not exactly a very mature technology at this point. Still requires highly skilled people to operate the systems and the software. And of course, the lack of standard generally, I would say this has improved over the last 5 years, but generally there's still some work that needs to be done to improve the production repeatability using 3D printing technology. The innovation dilemma is something that I won't elaborate too much here, but essentially for every businesses today, one of the key in some ways it's called innovator's dilemma, because most businesses for them to change require them to tear their own business model apart, so which means that they have to figure out a way to transition in such a way that they don't lose their core business. And so the progress itself has been rapid, and this is a curve that talks a little bit about the one of the barriers, which is the economies of using this technology. And you can see that the green curve, this is a relative cost against number of units. So as you go to higher units, the green curve shows the kind of curve, cost curve for using traditional manufacturing. So for high volume production, it does not make sense to use 3D printing. But if you're talking about using, doing a low volume parts, a low number of units, 3D printing itself makes sense. So this is what we mean earlier about doing high mix, low volume production. And of course, the design freedom enables this ability for the part to be created in such a way that instead of a solid part like the one you see on the left, where you start off, this is a kind of an injection molded part. So it's a lot solid, but with the software that we have today, we can then simulate the load bearing areas. So these are areas where you need to have material. And then once you have that, then you further optimize it and you create these very organic biomimicry kind of design, which serves just as well, but with 60% to 80% above reduction in material and therefore reducing costs. This is another example I mentioned about part consolidation. So you can see a turbine frame assembly. This is the example coming from the GE Aviation guys. So traditionally, 300 parts require 60 engineers, right, to engineer and then, of course, to assemble it. You have to source them from 50 different places around the world. You have to combine 40 data systems. And then if you need to repair them, you got to send them to different parts of the world to repair. As opposed to additive manufacturing, it becomes from 300 parts to one digital file. You require 8 highly skilled engineers to do the design, to do the simulation and the topology optimization. And then you have one manufacturing system to make it, to post-process it. And then of course, if there's a problem, you just have to repair it at one place. So this is what we mean by part consolidation. And beyond the production of actual end parts, 3D printing actually, or AM, can be used to create injection molds. Okay, some of these injection molds, you may wonder, what's the value of us doing injection molds when we can create the part itself, the end part using 3D printing? The middle example is probably the best to illustrate. So you can see a lot of these tiny blue channels. These are what we call conformal cooling channels. So when you make a part using injection molding, you got to basically heat up to basically so that when you pour in the resin or molten metal, you can maintain it and then immediately cool it down, right? So that the thing solidify, then you can, take out the part. And these conformal cooling channels cannot be produced using traditional manufacturing methods. And it can only be manufactured by itself using 3D printing, using the design freedom concept that I mentioned earlier. So this is a very valuable thing, right? So you can not only make the actual end product, but you can also make the molds. One of the concepts I like to quickly introduce is generative design. This is a very powerful thing and in some way relate back to this infinite computing. Because of the advent of compute power, we're now able to take any kind of product, very complex products, and go through these very complex generative design using computer compute power without using human process to develop a design envelope space that is functional. So that takes into consideration real world manufacturing constraints, of course, represented by analytical equations that's built into the software, and then to meet the product performance requirements. The other point is that I mentioned a lot about nature-inspired design. So you can see for yourself, this is I actually like this example a lot because it shows it is a design using AM software. And you can see for this one, it looks like exactly like a cross-section of the onion, right? So this is a image from Siemens on a turbine, one of the assembled systems for industrial applications in the oil and gas sector. Hyperganics, I mentioned this earlier, and this is a company, they are already in Singapore. In fact, they have a partnership with NTU. It was the company that we scouted 3 years ago, and they are currently in Singapore. They have a Singapore presence. Essentially, what they do is that they, instead of using traditional Autodesk type CAD software, They use computer coding using C# language to then back by some of these real-world manufacturing constraints represented by analytical equations. They are then the computer then use that to then generate the design themselves. And so unfortunately, we are not able to interact face to face, but this is a design of a rocket engine actually that was generated using their coding software. And you can see for yourself, I hope you can see this on screen. Traditionally this sort of design would have taken days or weeks even for engineers to work through using CAD software, using simulation software, to determine whether it's functional and can be built. But today with this software that they have created, this actually can be done overnight, literally overnight, using a very powerful laptop, of course. And so, the application today, since talking about rocket engines, is in the real life case, this is an example from SpaceX, which I'm sure everybody has heard about SpaceX. This is the engine combustion chamber, printed using ink and oil, using the powder bed fusion technology. And the rocket industry or the space industry actually is the first, in some ways, killer app of 3D printing. And for the reason that a lot of these rocket engines are extremely complex. I mentioned earlier about the concept of part consolidation. So you have less parts that you need to assemble, you need to weld together. That creates better reliability for the rocket performance. And more importantly, you can create these extremely tiny conformal cooling channels. It's maybe hard for you to see, but you can see these tiny holes there. These are actually cooling channels in the rockets itself. So if you can cool the rocket as you're blasting off, it actually saves fuel as well. And so beyond rocket engines, there are companies like Relativity Space. This is based in LA. It's a unicorn company. It's a $1 billion value company. They have built one of the largest customized 3D printing platform in the world to actually print rockets. These rockets look small on the screen, but trust me, this is actually one of their larger rockets called Terran R. So they've used basically additive manufacturing design using artificial intelligence and of course autonomous robotics to create these very intricate rocket structure and engines, which help them to reduce touch points and lead times, simplifying the supply chain. They don't have to do very complex casting, forging processes, and having to ship parts all over around the world. They just do it on site. And so it increases the product development cycle time. And more importantly, it helps them to quickly create, iterate their design cycle in order to help them to develop these rockets for deployment. Another example in the aerospace, and this is printed, this is actually another startup, Boom. So it's an aerospace company. So it aspires to essentially build these supersonic jets. And Valo3D is a recently public listed company. So they have a powder bed fusion technology that basically prints a lot of these 3D printed components that is performing all these critical engine operations this kind of aeros products. Now, switching gear a little bit, beyond aerospace, the maritime space, which is also a very important part of Singapore, you can see that this picture here from Ram Lab of Netherlands, this is a propeller. It's actually 3D printed. And let me just show you a video so that I can...
This is a Damen Standtag 1606 workboat. Many have come before it, and this will certainly not be the last. Still, this one is special, not because of what you see above the water, but because of what happens below the water. This vessel is propelled by the Wampeller, the first class-approved 3D-printed propeller. This project took 7 months to complete and brought together key players from different industries, all with the same goal, to manufacture and certify the world's first wire arc additive manufactured propeller. The starting point of the project was a propeller designed by ProMarin. Before it could be sent to the 3D printer, the design first had to be transformed into a so-called CAM strategy, a detailed plan of how the printing of the complex double-curved geometry of the propeller blades should be carried out. This strategy was thought out by Autodesk with the use of their PowerMill software application. Meanwhile, specialists at RAM Lab in Rotterdam started on tests to ensure the warm propeller would be strong enough for the job. Through different material tests and prototypes, the building strategy was finalized. In September of 2017, everything was set to start the production. By printing a total of 2.6 kilometers of nickel aluminium bronze in 298 layers, RAM Lab created the warm propeller in one go over just a few days, printing around the clock. With advanced 3D scanning methods, the propeller was checked and finished by ProMarin and deemed ready for testing. For the last stage of the project, the warm propeller was brought to Darman shipyards in Horkum, where it was installed on the Standtug 1606. What followed was a stringent trial program, including bollard pulling and crash stops. These trials turned out to be a big success. Shortly after, the warm propeller received its class approval from Bureau Veritas, making it the world's first class-approved 3D-printed ship's propeller, leading the way to a future where 3D-printed metal parts for the maritime sector will be business as usual.
Okay, I hope you enjoyed the video. So I thought this is a very interesting video. It helps to explain a lot of the concepts that I just mentioned earlier. In a way, it embodies the future, what I think this additive manufacturing can play in the space of manufacturing. And the other thing is that we visited RAM Lab a few years ago, and one of the not so well-known facts which they shared with us is these propellers actually are hollow in the center. So they actually use less materials than traditional method if you would have used casting or forging for this. And so it's much lighter, which means that the boat is much easier to actually power forward. Some of the other applications in AM beyond the fact that you can make these very large parts is actually repair. And this is one of the areas, especially from a recirculating economy perspective, in some of these sectors as well, is very important, right? So you can actually use some machining techniques to machine out the defective parts. Like in this gear example, you can see the section, the blackout area. These are the sections that need to be milled off. So once you machine off, you can then use additive manufacturing using the same technology I just shared earlier. Direct energy deposition method to create the gear to replace. And of course, in Singapore, we have our own version in some ways of this technology of WAM that was illustrated by the RAM Lab guys. So in SUTD, this technology we created, which is hybrid arc or WAM system, basically using wire feedstock. It has a computer visioning system, which then is able to decide, let the robot decide whether it can, as it layers up the material, it can do a machining in the same time. And so this has been commercialized by 3D Metal Forge, which is a Singapore-based 3D printing service bureau company, and has been deployed actually at PSA, part of Singapore, at the AM Center to produce these 3D printed twist lock pins. Which are used in hoisting containers. So its actual use is no longer just a photo. I want to, in the conscious of time, I'm going to speed through the last a few examples at the various sectors. So I think one of the other key focus and the use case of 3D printing is in medical device. And the reason for using it in medical device is to capitalize on the ability to personalize, to make the products, whether it's the anatomical models or surgical guides or even implants, to be very patient specific, that is individualized, and is not, that is not just off the shelf, right? That leads to better patient outcomes and of course better lower cost to healthcare systems. So one of the concepts that I quickly will talk through is these point of care delivery center. So what this means is that, and this is something that we just recently announced. So Johnson & Johnson has started a point of care clinical center at the National University Hospital. And the idea is actually for Johnson & Johnson engineers to be able to work very closely with clinicians to derive what are some of the products needed by the clinicians or the surgeons. To either to for them to help them do better pre-ops planning or do you know, surgical simulation and so on and so forth. So a lot of the products that's enabled on this is using 3D printing process. And from our side, we have been doing a lot of the initiatives working with our universities and hospitals as well as research institutes to create some of these medical devices, whether it's the surgical guides and models, or 3D printed drugs, or even looking at organs, tissue for tissue repair, or even some of these regenerative implants or prosthetics. So these are areas of great interest and great has great value if we are able to bring it from the development all the way through to patient adoption. And some of the products that we have looked at, and just a few examples here, like spinal implants, currently there's a work ongoing on this. And some of it, like even the orthopedic implants, the bone plates have successfully been developed and has passed animal trials, and which we are now actually taking forward to potentially for patient adoption. In the patient, at the patient adoption level, there are some of these products already out there in the market. Customized prosthesis. This is a kind of a ex vivo application, so it does not require as much regulatory oversight. And of course, bioresorbable implants. Actually, this is successfully commercialized and developed by a Singapore-based company, Osteopore International. So these bioresorbable implants, once it's put into your body, they over time, they actually dissolve into water and carbon dioxide. And because of the microstructure enabled by 3D printing process, it enables a process, what we call revascularization, which means blood vessels can grow and tissue can then be seeded from there. And it grows back, essentially the bony tissue. An example of what we have done in this space is working with this company, is a NUS spinoff. So they have developed their own 3D bioprinting platforms. And these platforms are in some ways proprietary. They are able to extract these plant proteins to build the composites material that they then use it to create these scaffolds, which you can, it's probably too small for you to see, but these scaffolds, think of it as, these are templates that we can actually use for any, for cell culture application, including whether for stem cell regeneration, as well as even for food manufacturing. On construction, this is a very, one of the areas that I think is of great interest, because as I mentioned, this technology or industry has not literally move in the last century or so. It's highly manual, very dangerous industry, not very difficult to actually standardize, because it's, you know, always done in the presence of elements like this, you know, sunshine or rain or storms. But if you can bring these production of these structural components to the factory, just like how we make typical consumer products, you can actually bring more standardization and quality consistency to the product. So this is a company, Apiscore. There are more companies now doing this right now. that we have worked with to look into automation of construction. Another facet to this is, of course, the use of recycled materials, which I emphasized a lot just now. This is a company, Minewis, which is from Taiwan. It has a presence in Singapore. And what they do is they basically gather all these consumer waste, primarily plastics, and basically re-engineer these materials to create a specialized material that can be used for architecture, for building facades, and other structural applications. And this is an actual, you know, not the marketing gimmick, but they actually have created this, what they call a trash presso, not espresso, but trash presso, where you throw in the PET bottles and, you know, the machine itself is a recycling system. It will basically spew out the these recycled PET plastic pallets, which can be used as a feedstock. And this is the materials that I mentioned, they can engineer for use in building facades. Yeah, it's a bit too small, but actually that in the background is indeed Jackie Chan, who is a Hong Kong actor. So he was there to promote this. And this is a real building facade example that they actually use, where they use all these drink bottles and recycled plastic to create a facade. I mean, if people don't say this is, you know, if they didn't share with us this was actually made using recycled plastics, nobody would have known. But this is an actual example, the Water Conservation Museum in Taipei. So if you have a chance to go to Taiwan, you can see it for yourself. And of course, in the context of Singapore, we are very much motivated to make this, using this technology, AM, from design to feedstock, to minimizing the transport, to reducing carbon footprint, in order to support our sustainability push. And these are some of the few examples that we looked at. We looked at how to replace sand with some of these fly ash byproducts, which is incinerated waste byproducts. And we've been able to, this is an NTU initiative, actually, with Samcorp Industries. They created this very beautiful 3D printed bathroom unit that is actually on display in the Singapore Center for 3D Printing. So if you have a chance, do sound out your professors, or you can come, you can also send me an email. We can arrange a tour. And of course, on the maritime side, this is a company, Wilhelmsen Ship Services. They control one third of the total ship services. And they are now looking into using 3D printing for creating all these on-demand ship spares to support the maritime sector. And a few other examples, DB Schenker. This was a very cool example that I actually personally visited last week at Changi. So this is a work that was being supported together with Singapore University Technology and Design. There's a video actually. Okay. And you can see that, there's a huge robot basically moving slowly. And these are actually made with recycled PET pallets. And this machine, of course, is created by SUTD, and they were able to create these massive, very nice, organic looking light architecture. And this is not currently on display at DB Schenker's Singapore HQ, and they're gonna launch it very soon. Another example in the agri-tech space, which is urban farming. As you know, Singapore is moving towards self-sustainability in food. So we have been able to work with these Nita Tech Farm, which is based in Lim Chu Kang. And they basically use 3D printing to create, again, using recycled plastic to create these life-size floating farms, actually, which can be used for some of their urban needs, urban farming needs. I thought it's useful. I think some of you may have heard about food printing. So this is a company called Redefined Meat. The concept is all about, building sustainability into basically agriculture. So today, I think for those of you who loves meat, not a lot of you will know that, it takes a lot of resources for us to just rear 1,000 cows, right? And it takes a lot of water, takes a lot of grass, and plus they also emit a lot of the global warming gases. And so if we can take this production of meat from the fields and metals to the factory, right, using this printer, for example, as an illustration, you can actually make a lot of good, right, on industrial, on the environmental impact. And the approach, of course, this is a schematic, is that with the technology today, you can actually create these multiple extruder systems where you could actually extrude fats, blood, muscles, and all that. And because, as I mentioned earlier, 3D printing is a digital design, as a digital technology, you can create very intricate, complex, what I call arteries of these complex mixing of blood, muscles, and fat to create these kind of real meat, right? It looks, you can see a bit of pixelation in the meat with the fats and all that, but this is actually what they created. And I have an example that showed people actually testing the meat. It actually tastes exactly like the beef steak that actually comes from cows originally. So it's no longer a science fiction that people can do this. Of course, the question now is, how do you scale, right? So just like with any new technology, and this is something that this startup is now working on to scale. And of course, on the last point is the social impact. And this is a very good example. I like to just highlight working with SG Enable, which is a government initiative for the unfortunate, for those people who are handicapped. So we are able to use 3D printing to create some of these gadgets, especially in this case, is a customized joystick knob for motorized wheelchair. So most motorized wheelchair today is you have these very round joystick knob, which is not very good for a lot of the handicapped people. So they wanted something a little bit more ergonomically designed for that purpose. And this was done by Republic Polytechnic. So in conclusion, I want to end here by saying that I've given you a lot of examples. I've shown you that this technology is one of the key enablers to bridge the digital to physical divide. It's sustainable in a way, but we need to find a way, of course, to scale it. And of course, I think this is just an introduction. There's a lot more to this. A lot more details. If you are interested to find out more, just do feel free to reach out to me. I'm actually currently still based in NTU, so you can find my name easily if you search my name in the email box. And of course, I welcome comments, feedbacks to this in any way, including the Q&A to follow now. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Ho, for your very insightful sharing. So, ladies and gentlemen, as we move on to our Q&A session, we would like to bring your attention to our QR code for you to scan and input your question into and the bottom of the screen. Do include the hashtag TechIgnite in small letters to access the platform to input your question. So, Dr. Ho, you've touched on the usefulness of additive manufacturing in many areas of the industry, in the aerospace industry, electronics and manufacturing sector. But in this pandemic era, I feel that many of us can relate more to the medical side of the field. So can you please share with us, how is 3D printing relevant in this pandemic era?
Yeah, it's a good question. We actually undertook, this was a national initiative that took place last year. At the peak of the crisis, because of the shutdown of all the national borders. So we actually had a shortage of these PCR test kits, right? The PCR test kit, as most of you would know, it has this swab, nasopharyngeal swab, which is like a stick with a little bit of like a cotton bud thing at the tip. And of course you have a test vial with some of these solution, right? To capture these viral load. And so 3D printing actually was used to design, we actually used it to design a Singapore-made 3D printed nasopharyngeal swab. We were able to do this within 7 weeks from the time when we started, from ground zero. As compared to, of course, we were working on an injection molded version, which took us about 5 months. From a cost perspective, each of these swap costs about $1. But for short-term supply needs, there's no doubt that, you know, this was actually able to mitigate some of the, in some ways, the limited task capacity that Singapore had back in 2020. So this is one example. The other example, of course, is some of these ventilator systems. I think for people who needs critical care. So there was also a shortage of these kind of medical equipment. So 3D printing was actually used to open source, right? So a lot of the open source designs were out there. You could just download it and then you can manufacture it using the 3D printers that is quite widely available. And then of course you can deploy it easily. Face shield frames was another example that was done. There was a company in Singapore called Siege AM. So they are a 3D printing service bureau. They in fact manufacture a lot of these face shield frames that they then made it available, you know, on a social basis to free of charge actually to a lot of the more underprivileged communities.
Thank you, Dr. Ho. So 3D printing has really made Singapore a much more self-reliant country, as we can produce our own test kit and ventilator. So following up with the next question.
Yeah, just to follow up, right? Previous question was about how 3D printing in the medical sector, more on the test swab kits, which are like things that are used physically, right? I've recently read about 3D printed tumor cancer cells that aid in the study and planning of medical procedures to treat patients. I'm pretty sure this is some with relation with NTU and NAMIC and their collaboration. How well is, you know, a sculpture essentially able to mimic the complex biological nature of cancer cells? And maybe if you could give us some insight on some other future plans on NTU and NAMIC collaborations.
Yeah, sure. I think the technology today, as far as bioprinting is concerned, you can print, you know, bioscaffolds, you can print some of these, what we call soft tissues, but it's not able to so-called print cells at this point. But what it can do very well is quite well established is if you have, let's say a spinal cancer, you know, with tumor problem, which is usually means it's very complex and it's very personalized to the patient. You can do the CT scan or MRI scan, and then they will then use that DICOM data to translate it to a CAD software to design, to look at, basically to create these anatomical model, right, of the cancer area, right? So that, and then you can print out using the technology that we have today with the details that is needed to elucidate what's the you know, nature of the disease and allow the surgeons to do these pre-ops planning, plus even including surgical rehearsal, right? So they actually take these models and, you know, we have these soft materials, silicon-based material that you can create and you can actually practice surgery on it. So what it happens, and this is already proven by feedbacks from surgeons, is that with this kind of approach, they're able to save a lot of time and they're able to get better outcomes because they, you know, just like anything else, more preparation is better than no preparation. And also importantly, they're able to better communicate the problem with the patient. So it helps patients to assuage some of the concerns and even with the patient's family. Now, in terms of the initiative that we will undertake with NTU, I think I didn't spend too much time explaining that we are essentially a cluster, and the Singapore Center for 3D Printing is one of our founding members of NAMIC. You know, we work very closely with the research performers in NTU, both in as Singapore Center for 3D Printing, as well as other research performers from other departments as well. So the main areas of, I would say, collaboration that we are now planning to undertake is, of course, in the areas where NTU is very strong. For example, in the process engineering, in mechanical aerospace, in maritime, marine offshore, and even in bioprinting. There's some work that is done by some ME professors in bioprinting itself. And of course, material science, right? The material development is something very, very powerful. As you can see from the examples I've given on some of the recycled feedstock. In some ways, the future of this technology is can be unlimited if you can create the kind of materials that can meet the needs of the product solution.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Ho, for that insightful the depth that you brought us, like on the insight on 3D printing in the medical field. I think Joanne has a question.
Sure. Yes, there's a question from the audience, and I think this is much more relatable to them. So, there's a question: as a year one mechanical engineering student, how can they get an exposure to the additive manufacturing industry? Since what you mentioned before, 3D printing seems kind of far-fetched for a JC student, since it sounds very technical. And also, what advice do you think you can give to them as their first step in to step into this industry?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I do apologize. I've not kept up to date on the latest curriculum, the undergraduate curriculum in NTU and generally the universities, because I do lecture, but mostly at the postgraduate level. But I would say this, and this is true, is that this is a multidisciplinary technology. So it doesn't matter whether you're a mechanical engineering student, electrical engineering student, material science student, or even chemical engineering student. It's cross-disciplinary. If you are really keen to learn more about this, I believe there's modules now offered in NTU. I think at the undergrad level, there's some introductory course into 3D printing. Of course, it doesn't go into the depth and of course the applications that I just shared. Each one of this actually is a lot more, there's a lot more details behind. But if you're really, really keen, I think I really highly encourage students here to think about taking on postgraduate courses, whether it's the master's level or even going to do a PhD. Because I think a lot of these, it's relatively, I'm sure you heard about the term deep tech or deep science. I think the future, in my introduction, I mentioned about the many problems that's currently facing us. We need more scientists and engineers to be able to help solve some of these problems. And so today, I would say in the current context, continuous learning is the key. It's not so much about whether you have a PhD or master's. I think to learn continuously is very important. There are a lot of courses out there. Even if you can't find the one that you think fits what you are interested in because of the natural progress you have to go through, in the undergraduate curriculum, you can sign up. We have a lot of these webinars that we actually is free of charge. We just started a NAMIC.TV platform. It's on the online, it's free. We're gonna put up a lot of the webinars and the videos that we have, plus together with our partners. So just being exposed to these, webinars, even though it might be, at the introductory level, maybe down to a bit intermediate, will be good enough to you to give you a sense of whether this is something that you would like to deep dive more, right, in your future studies. So I think there's a lot of courses, like I said, but I think I don't think there's no lack of courses in Singapore as far as I can tell.
That's correct. It's really heartening to know that you're educating the younger generation as well. Just to add on to that, NTU is also the Singapore Center for 3D Printing that Dr. Ho mentioned. And right now the center is currently also working at food printing. So by joining NTU, you'll be able to gain different exposure to all the different workshops that we have to offer within or outside of the curriculum so that you can explore more of your interests here. Next up, we have another question. Can 3D printing contribute to the wireless power transfer?
Okay. Well, as you would imagine, 3D printing is a physical fabrication technology. So we've actually used it to create antennas, 5G for basically 5G applications. And in fact, in some of the work that we actually directly supported, because of the design freedom, we have shown that it can be a lot more, these transmissivity can be a lot more better using the design and the fabrication using 3D printing. So absolutely. The application space is unlimited, I would say, but it's a physical fabrication technology. So as well as also in a way, digital technology. I didn't want to go too much into this earlier, but you know, even you think about the recent craze and talk about metaverse. So you could think about the future where, and this is probably not something that I would appreciate, but I guess the younger generation will appreciate a lot, is if you're living in this kind of a metaverse universe, you can create these digital twins of the products that you want and you want to sell. And because of the advent of blockchain, you have these what you call production ecosystem in a metaverse that anyone can just pick up the design using these NFT or you know, they call it basically it's a representation of the digital representation of the design itself. You can then, they can then take this and then produce it, and then they will then ship it to basically whoever orders these kind of products in the metaverse universe. So it's a kind of future vision of what we think how 3D printing can be even be related to these future world of living in a kind of a virtual reality type of environment, because ultimately every one of us still need to eat, we still need to wear stuff. I mean, you can't just lie on a bed and put on your a headgear and just live, right? So the physical part of it is really what I think 3D printing can enable, and it will still always be relevant, whether it's talking about metaverse or even in the current physical society.
So it seems that 3D printing can almost be used and is applicable in almost all sector of the industry. Well, due to time constraint, I'm sorry to say that will be the last question in this Q&A. So thank you everyone for joining this session. And we hope that this session has ignited your interest in the 3D printing field. Do remember that we have two more talks lined up for this December on the 11th, which we will talk more about the sustainability in the coastal reclamation. This will be a very interesting topic because coastal reclamation is usually seen as a thing that contributes to marine pollution. So in this talk, we will see how the Surbana Jurong, people in Surbana Jurong work together in order to do coastal reclamation in a more sustainable method. And aside from that, we also have another talk lined up on the 17th of December entitled Smart Transportation, to discuss about the future mobility for Singapore. And if you have any more questions for Dr. Ho, you may leave it in our Slido page and we will leave them and we will share them with Dr. Ho. Or alternatively, you can contact Dr. Ho himself through his NTU email, as he mentioned earlier before. So thank you everyone for attending our talks and have a nice evening.
Thank you, Joanne, and thank you, Sarah. Thank you very much.